City Council meeting to order, and I'd like to ask the Boy Scout troop, that is 55, to come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Your attention. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And gentlemen, before you leave, let me give you a pin that you can add to your badges. Thank you very much for coming in. I hope are you going to stick around for a little bit longer?
Yes.
Good, to see what else we do? These guys. Thank you all for coming in. We really appreciate that. We've had a lot of news lately, a lot of news across the United States. Bad news affecting our police officers all over the United States. And at this moment, I'd like to just take a moment of silence in prayer for all of those individuals who have lost their lives in the line of duty. I thank you for joining me in that moment of silence. We'd like to keep all those individuals in mind, too. It's tragic events that keep happening. Let's hope, cross our fingers, that it doesn't continue. Let's move on with our agenda. The roll, please.
Schauer.
Here.
MacIver.
Here.
Marquez.
Here.
Kenny.
Here.
Klistic.
Here.
Belzak.
Here.
Belke.
Here.
Seven present.
We have a quorum. The next item is questions, comments, and announcements of a general nature. Does anyone in the audience want to address the council on any items? It doesn't have to be an item on our agenda this evening, merely an item that you wanted to discuss and maybe can't stick around for the whole meeting. Let's move on then. Let's move on to the approval of the minutes of June 20th, 2016. I guess I didn't. Come on up. Come on up. Do you want to come up to the microphone, please?
Sure. How's everybody doing tonight?
Good.
Hope y'all are doing well and staying cool. It's hot out there.
Your name, please?
My name is Sam Musa. My family owns Brewster's Chicken. We've owned Brewster's Chicken for about 22 years now here in Darien. We own the business as well as the property, and we've been very loyal to Darien for a long time. We love it out here. And the reason I'm here today is because of a couple things. A few months back, I sat in front of many of the same people that I see here, and a few years back, I'm sorry, and I sat in front of you guys and I asked for a beer and wine license to bring into my establishment. The reason I asked is because business wasn't doing so well, and I thought maybe it could help raise our, you know, our profits. And We went ahead and I followed all the rules you guys asked for, and I went ahead and got my beer and wine license. It cost me $2,000 to get that, $1,500 to the city and $500 to the state of Illinois. Anyways, to make a long story short, we tried it out for a couple months. I applied for the license without knowing that it needed to be renewed every July. I didn't know that. I ended up getting my license in end of February, beginning of March, after everything was said and done. After we got the license, we tried it for a couple months, and then I got a renewal letter that I had to renew. Well, like I said, we got the license because business wasn't doing too well, so it was hard to dish up another $2,000 to reapply. So after we seen the 4 or 5 months that we had it, it wasn't working out too well. So we said, you know what, let's just scrap the idea of beer and wine in the business. Now I'm looking to get my beer and wine license back. Now, we didn't lose our license. We never had it revoked. We never got any penalties for anything we did in our establishment. But the only reason we still don't have it is because we just decided not to renew. So we're looking to renew again. And I've been noticing a lot of businesses here in Darien, as well as other suburbs, are having gaming machines. I know a lot of cities are trying to restrict the amount of machines they are now putting in these establishments, which is understandable because now it's becoming kind of like the lottery. You know, every stop you go to, there's a lottery machine there. But I wanted to get my gaming license, and I wanted to reapply for my liquor license, my beer and wine license. I approached the city, I got all the paperwork, and then I received an email from the city saying that the only way that I will be granted my beer and wine license is if I sign a document saying I will not bring gaming into my establishment. Now, the reason I'm here in front of you guys today is because, like I said, we've owned Brewster's for 22 years. Businesses like Chuck's come into the area that's a franchise that they don't need the machines. They're making money regardless. You know, they're big-time guys. I know the owners of Chuck's. They're big-time guys. They don't need the machines. Small mom-and-pop shops need those machines because, I'll be honest with you, we're struggling. It's tough. It's really hard. And if we didn't own the property, I wouldn't be able to pay rent to whoever my landlord was because it's just not as good as it used to be. We used to do very well, and now we're not doing so well. So the machines kind of, I have a lot of family in the restaurant business that have machines, and it's not that they're saving their lives by the machines, but it's helping. It's helping pay the rent. It's helping pay the bills at the end of the month. It's helping them. So in my opinion, you know, for a guy like me that has been in Darien for 22 years and has been working here day and night, I worked for my father for many years. My dad retired. Now I am the owner of the business. You know, we're the ones that have been supporting Darien for the longest time. I feel that if anyone was to get the machines, it should be to the people that have been around for so long and have been supporting Darien. And, you know, I've donated to the VFW in Darien. I've done everything. I've done it all. I've advertised in the churches in Darien. I've done everything you could possibly think of. And I see a lot of faces here today that come into our restaurant, you know? And that makes me feel good because, yeah, even though business is not doing so well, you guys enjoy the food. You guys like the food. You wouldn't come to the restaurant if the food wasn't good, right? Or the service. And we try here in Brewster's to give the best service and the best food and the best quality of everything. Now, I don't want you guys to think, I know I'm taking up too much time, but I don't want you guys to think that I'm trying to turn Brewster's into a gaming parlor or whatever these places are called, like Dottie's and all these other places that are opening up. That's not my focus. My focus is my restaurant. But we do a lot of catering in Brewster's in the summertime. We get catering, graduation parties, weddings, that kind of stuff. When we get those orders, some people come in unexpectedly and they order 15, 20, 30 whole chickens. Well, it takes some time to prep those chickens. So while they're waiting, if they sit around in a dining room that has a couple machines in it, it's helping me. It's helping the city because I know the city gets a percentage. And it gives them something to do, and it gets them not so in a rush to make me hurry up with their food, make me rush it. Because when you rush something, it doesn't always turn out the best quality. So I put TVs back in the back of the restaurant, in the dining room, years ago. That helped a little bit. And I think these gaming machines would help too. So that's why I'm here today. I mean, whatever I have to do to, I'll draw up a plan. I'll present a plan to you guys of how I'm planning, where I'm planning to put the machines or what I'm planning to do. But that's basically why I'm here today. And I hope you guys see eye to eye with me and understand where I'm coming from with this whole thing.
Yeah, I was the one that motivated the no to you on that. My feeling is we have more than enough gaming machines in the city of Darien, and we knew when you applied for the liquor license where you were going with that, and that's why we said to you that we would grant you the liquor license again, provided that you agreed not to put any gaming machines in. And that's the way I feel, and that's the way it stands right now. I don't know if the council feels that they want to address this issue at a committee meeting, but that's my feeling. That's where I stand on the issue.
Well, Mayor, in addition, you know, we had brought this up with the council. The staff periodically gets requests for new businesses in town that want to locate, and so we had polled the council a while back, and the direction we were given is, again, any new liquor license that the city would consider would be subject to some kind of an agreement where they wouldn't bring in gaming. So we were following, at least at that time, what the council's direction was, so.
But I also thought we were going to not make a blanket statement, and it was going to be on a case-by-case basis. And I think Mr. Busta makes a valid point that it's a business that's been in town for 22 years, and he's looking for a little help from the city. We didn't have problems with, you know, with Chuck's and Zazzo's and all these other newer businesses have come in. And I would, you know, I know his primary business is restaurant, not like a couple of the other establishments.
It's mostly takeout catering.
Dining too. I have some seats.
Yeah, okay. It's not a major restaurant, yes.
Right, so I would not have a problem, because his restaurant's small. I couldn't see him putting five machines in there. But
I don't think it would fit.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind to see him put maybe two or, you know, maybe two machines in there. I don't think it's that much of a eyesore or something. It's against what we're trying to do in Darien, and I think we're trying to help a Darien business out, so I'd be for it.
Alderman MacIver?
I have a question regarding, have we, in the businesses that had gaming machines, have we had any that have closed and machines have gone away? Like, for instance,
Linote. That's the only one that comes to mind.
Yeah,
but
so I guess, you know, in my opinion, if we're sort of net, you know, if we lose some and then have someone come back, if we kind of are trying to keep sort of a balanced number, I mean, that might be something to consider.
One machine is too many in my mind.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's obviously a demand for it because, you know, it's here. I mean, we have them in Darien. It's not like, you know, we have zero in Darien, so.
So we would, so if that were to happen with Brewster's, it would be a net, we're saying?
Well, like, for instance,
because
so
of,
if.
Right,
yeah.
But is it a net, I'm asking.
Yeah, I don't know. Right. Yeah, I don't know the number on that.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I don't recall any others that have closed down.
And how many do they have?
I think we have received requests, and the businesses have agreed to sign the agreement not to put in machines. Have we had that situation yet?
Well, most of the businesses that have contacted us are along, you know, the lines of Dottie's, that type of business. One came to the council that wanted to do a, you know, they claimed to be a deli, and they actually presented to the council.
Yes.
But I don't think we've had any that have said, yeah, I'll sign an agreement that, you know, I don't want
to. Well, that's what we presented to those businesses, and,
yeah,
they,
anybody
and
that
they walked away.
Us.
They walked
yeah,
away.
Yeah,
yeah,
so we have
they
not
walked
had
away.
Any, Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think we've had any that said, well, sure, I'll sign an agreement. I still want my license. I don't remember.
Right, the last one was along the lines, like you said, the deli, but the deli was basically the same takeoff of Estella's, was the
right,
same concept
right.
that,
yeah.
in that respect.
Yeah.
In addition, there's fees for the gaming license and applications and things.
I'm aware. Okay. Yeah, I'm aware of the fees and the licenses. And yeah, I mean, I did my research. And you know, unfortunately, places like Dottie's and Stella's, they approached the cities, and they basically lied to the cities and what their game plan was. I know some of the people involved in those type of businesses. They made it look a lot more like a cafe and a hangout than a small-time casino. That's basically what it is. And many cities are upset with them, you know, and they kind of set the bad picture. But as far as my case goes, I'm not going to sit here and advertise, hey, video poker. That's not what I'm going to do. Here, I'll tell you guys one statistic. In Brewster's, we get 60 to 70 customers a day. That's it. 60 to 70 customers a day. Now, the only reason we're surviving is because our something in the restaurant business, which is PPR, which is basically price per customer, how much each customer is spending in your restaurant. Because these 60 to 70 people coming in are spending an average of $16 a person because they're feeding their entire family for 16, 17 bucks. We're a ma-and-pa shop. We're not a big-time restaurant where you gourmet and dress fancy, and that's not us. That's not what we've been for. It's been there for 30 years, but we've owned it for 22. So that's not who we are. And I'm, like I said, I really want you guys to understand that I'm not trying to turn my restaurant that we've spent so many years in into a gaming parlor. That's not what I'm doing at all, because I have loyal customers. You know, in the restaurant business, we have the 80-20 rule.
80% of your business comes from 20% of your customers. Those regulars of mine that are dedicated to Brewster's and eat at my restaurant weekly, sometimes multiple days in a week, are my loyal customers. I'm not gonna lose them because of my gaming machines. You understand? Mm-hmm. If I changed it to a parlor, they probably wouldn't come back.
You know what? I think you have to do a great deal of weighing on this issue. You're going to be talking about paying a fee for a liquor license. You've already expressed that, yeah, about the $2,000 for
correct,
that.
Correct.
Then the gaming license and all those fees. You have to weigh that against the fact that you may be able to put two machines in your establishment. That's it. I think you need to do some gauging of is it worth your while to even consider doing it?
Well, the reason we didn't reapply or renew our license was because we had it for such a short period of time. Now, I'm coming to you.
Well, besides that point, you could have renewed and saw what your liquor license revenue would have been for a whole year.
I didn't have the money right then and there to renew it because I had just dished out.
Well, now you're talking about a liquor license and all the fees you have to pay to the state. Are you going to be able to afford all that? I mean, I'm asking a rhetorical question at this point.
Okay.
But as far as I'm concerned, I'm not hearing a great deal of support from the city council.
Maybe we have a straw poll because we've only heard from a couple aldermen.
Well, I guess the question was, when Lenote closed, how many machines went dark on that closure? Do we know how many they had?
Oh, and no, I don't recall off the top of my head, but there's a limit.
Five
per the law allows you to have five, so Brewster's could have five machines in.
Right.
They fit, but like I said, if you guys have been there, I don't think it'll fit.
Well,
the
question then would be, would you be willing to say, okay, look, you know, because how many people come in an hour? I mean, in your place?
Not many.
Okay, so if you had two machines, like, so if in lieu of the, you know, the, you get a liquor license and no machines agreement, would you agree to, and I'm not saying this is an option that's out there, I'm just kind of spitballing here, but you know, if there was a, you know, you would agree to, look, you're only trying to let people that are waiting for their orders and they're interested in doing it to, you know, would you limit it to, like, say, two machines?
I definitely signed something saying that I could get some, however many machines, compared to getting no machines, because
okay.
I don't think I'd sign anything saying I'm not going to get any machines, because okay. I don't think it's fair. I mean, Like I said, that's why I'm here.
Greg, Chief Thomas, would you happen to know the laws on these video gaming machines? Does the state come out, review the location, and then decide how many machines may fit into a location?
I don't.
You don't know? Okay.
The distributor does. The distributor that brings the machines, they come out and they measure and they see what you could fit. Because obviously there's laws of... you know, for handicapped people in wheelchairs, you got to have enough room for everything.
And it has to be behind. You have to be separated from the rest of the restaurant.
Correct.
It's 21 and old.
Correct. There has to be some type of separation from the dining room and the machines, whether it's two machines or five, however many machines you have to have separation between them and the dining people because you don't want to irritate the people that are sitting down eating that don't want to play the games. And also, they come in, they do all the measuring because, you know, when you obviously got to take into consideration when you move a chair back, how much space you need, and they do all the measuring and all that type of stuff. Like I said, we have family.
Yeah, Alderman Clistic, did you have a question?
Yeah, just a quick question. You mentioned Brewster's a very family-oriented restaurant or whatnot. Mm-hmm. When I walk around town and look at, for example, Dottie's, I don't see too many families in Dottie's and other establishments that do gambling. So I guess, do families gamble a lot then? That's the question.
I'll be honest
so
with
the
you.
Customer, what I'm looking at is the customer base is completely different.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm trying to understand the justification of saying, you know, a family of five comes in there are going to gamble versus, you know, doing something else. So are you looking for an older clientele or different type of clientele from out of Darien? I mean, what's sort of the marketing strategy? Because it's two completely customers, you know,
that
I'm looking
at. I
completely
see where you're going and what you're
and
saying.
And I don't understand sort of
yeah,
like the
absolutely.
Reasoning for the... machines, I guess.
Absolutely. Well, here, I'll tell you this. Dottie's only goes into shopping centers with supermarkets. Why? Because they target the women. Women drop their kids off at school. They do the shopping. They have nothing to do. They go gamble. Look it up. I mean, they target the women. It's
all right,
the,
now
it's
you're...
It's true.
Sam, I would
make broad statements like that.
I'm being honest. You know,
see a couple of women here?
No, I'm... seriously, I don't know if you guys ever been into a Dottie's.
No, that is their demographic.
Sam, I'm gonna listen to what some of the other aldermen have to say.
I don't want
to beat this dead horse here. I want to hear from the other aldermen what they feel. And whether or not, yeah.
Well, my feeling is that, Alderman, I think Kenny said it correctly when we discussed this, while we did agree on certain parameters, we did say that we would take a look at each case individually. In my mind, Brewster's has been in the community for a long time versus some of these other establishments. We buy from Brewster's maybe once a week, maybe once every couple of weeks. I think it's worthy of examining again at a committee level. I would have no problem with that.
Alderman Schauer?
I was one of the first guys that always was against video gambling in the city of Darien, but you're making an argument about the fact that you're probably challenged with income, and put it to you this way, I'm open to the idea. I'm not guaranteeing that we're talking about it, but I'm open to it.
You know, Sam, I really stood up here and told us that you're having hard times financially. You're going to be forking out a whole bunch of money here for a liquor license and all of this stuff. That's why I said to you, I think you need to measure this, where you're going to come out. If you're going to have maybe two machines in your whole place with people that come in to get carryouts, I don't see it happening, and I think you need to really take a good look at the cost, because you told us that your business is not doing well, and this is a great deal of expenditure you're looking at. Alderman Belke, I mean,
it's a business decision. You're the business. But I would say that if we get a little more facts as far as where we are netting, you know, the number of machines we had before, I think the idea in general was to just make sure it doesn't get kind of out of control. But as far as your argument about, you know, you've been in business, blah, 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 that part was just logistically, you know, where the other ones came forward first. That's all. That's all. That's how that happened. But I'm open to reviewing it again and getting a little more information.
Alderman Belzec, I don't think I heard from you.
Yeah. I've never used any of those machines in my life and don't plan on it. And it's not something for me. But that said, I would not be adverse to reviewing this particular scenario. I would like to limit the number of machines. And if we can work out, hammer out an agreement where it is two or something like that, I certainly would be open to reviewing that.
Alderman Clistic, I got a feel for where you were going, but what is your opinion?
Yeah, I'm not a super big fan. I guess I don't quite understand how the families are going to be part of the gaming facility. I mean, I have residents who do go to Dottie's, and it's just a different type of customer that, you know, that I would see not using it. So
if you don't mind me, I thought I heard him say that the machines wouldn't be so much for the person sitting down with a family of five as to his catering business waiting for orders for those.
Comments. You can't assume anything, Alderman Kenny.
We can't assume that he's not going to be able to make a business decision either, Mayor. And then when he can't come up with the money, we can't assume that he's not going to be able to handle it.
I don't understand that comment.
Well, you've said you're assuming that he's not going to be able to make a business decision about the money concerned. That's his decision. We shouldn't be making.
That's why I said what I said.
Okay.
That it's his. He's got to weigh how much money he's going to be putting out for this, as opposed to even how much revenue you're going to make on that.
I'm aware.
Yes.
I know I'm not a voting member, but for whatever it's worth, last time I think I brought up that Lenote and did close down, so theoretically it would free that up if we were trying to keep it on a par. And I guess I differentiate what Brewster's is doing compared to a new business coming in. Like he said, he's been a part of the community for a long time, and to the extent we can work with someone that has been contributing to the community for a long time, I think that makes more sense than opening it up to someone that hasn't been here before and just expanding the number. This, again, we would expand it to where we were before, but again, as well as helping somebody that has been a contributing member to the community for a long period of time. But again, not a voting member, just my outside perception.
Okay.
And, you know, we go to Chuck's all the time, and, you know, they have it, and it's not seedy or anything. I mean, it's just like you see some people kind of, like, behind something that looks like a, you know, just a like a video game, just a video game kind of thing. So, I mean, I never get, you know, I go with my family. They're not offended by seeing that or anything like that.
Are those families gambling or no?
No, it's like you have to be 21 to gamble. I don't know who the people are. And actually, to be honest, you know, if I go there and there's maybe one person sitting there, I'm surprised. You know, it's not.
And it's roped off, I believe, and it's segregated.
It's not roped off. It's just a divider. That's all.
Yeah. But I mean, it's not like there's a line of people waiting to use those machines or anything like that. It's, I don't know.
You'd be surprised how much they make.
We've seen the numbers, so we are surprised.
It's on the gaming on the website.
Right,
so
we already
could,
know.
Yeah. You could see. I mean,
and just one last comment too. It is gambling. Some people do have addictions to gambling, so sometimes I have a concern bringing more gambling as well into Darien because maybe a few people have issues. They go there once and they're hooked again, and maybe they're spending money they shouldn't be as well.
I mean,
so I know
get
you
it,
don't
but,
control
but,
that, but you know, other people.
If I was the only person in Darien with machines, I completely agree with you. I mean, but. You have a ton of establishments out here that have them.
People are addicted to alcohol, and we give out liquor licenses, too. So.
You know what I mean? So I'd agree with you completely if I was the only one.
Hmm?
You know, if I was the only one, I'd be like, yeah, you're right.
Okay, thanks for coming to our meeting.
Absolutely.
I appreciate that. Okay,
thank you.
We'll
thank
consider
you.
It, yes.
Thank you.
So, Mayor, that would go on the next committee?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you?
He's got to apply for a liquor license.
It's not a renewal.
It's a liquor. He has to reply. He has to go through that process.
Go to the committee.
Oh, okay. Yeah, but he'd have to reapply again.
Oh, correct, yeah. But I think what he's asking, is, before he applies, he wants to know if the city's interested in creating a new license. So my point was, if we had an existing license, it wouldn't go to a committee. But now, as the mayor said, it would go to Municipal Services at, I believe, their next meeting.
August 22nd.
Okay. All right, we were just about to vote on the approval of the minutes. Did we do a roll call on that? We don't have a motion or...
Correct.
Okay. Do I have someone to motion to approve Alderman Schauer the minutes of June 20th? Alderman Marquez seconded it. Any additions or deletions to the minutes? Then the roll, please.
Schauer?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
Kenny?
Abstain.
Belke?
Aye.
MacIver?
Aye.
6 ayes and 1 abstention.
The minutes have been approved. Let's move to receiving of communications. Do any of the aldermen have communications this year? Alderman Kenny?
I think I have a few pages, Mayor. Good evening. I have a communication from James Halderman from Burridge residents regarding smart meters and wanted to let the city of Darien know that the village of Burridge passed a resolution for opt in, opt out. It was a non-binding resolution. I had a follow-up conversation with Judith LaRose, who was here at our meeting here last November. I've had communication from Mr. Musa, which we've just spoken to from Brewster's. I've had communications with a couple of residents that are going to remain nameless that were pointing out some RVs / boats in driveways and in the street area. And I got a response back from Mr. John Dietrich, who happens to be in our audience tonight, from 7218 Bayberry regarding a boat that he has on his driveway, and staff has already been to his property. That is all I have. Thank you.
I met with Mr. Halderman this evening at my meet and greet, and I told him that he could connect with with Administrator Vienna to set a date for him to come in and make his presentation to the council on his opinions on the smart meters. So that will be something we will be listening to in the future. Alderman Belke?
I received a communication from a resident at the 100 block of Janet. This has to do with the construction that's going on with the ditching for the Sunrise project. So myself and Dan have already been in contact with him, and we are working towards a resolution. It's mainly due to the disturbance of his residence area in front, and just wants to make sure that it's restored to the same way it was.
Okay, gotcha. Okay. I did want to bring us up. There's been some questions. We received some communications regarding the lowering of our flag and the protocol that is followed for the lowering of our American flag, and I'd like to have Administrator Vanna address that issue, because there is a protocol for, we've had a number of instances lately where we've been called upon to lower the flag for the incident in Dallas, and there's probably going to be another one for Baton Rouge and other incidences, but there is a protocol for when we do lower the flag. So, Brian, do you want to mention?
Yeah, simply it's a presidential proclamation regarding lowering the flag and when the flag would be lowered, and we get that automatically in an email to municipal services. Once that proclamation comes from the president, then we follow that.
Okay. So that it's not something that we just take upon ourselves to just lower the flag just because. It's always because of a presidential proclamation, correct?
Correct, thank you.
Okay, all righty. Just for the information. Any other communications to share? Let's move to the mayor's report, and we have Ms. Emily Glassberg with us this evening to give us an update on the mosquito abatement program.
We did a trial run this afternoon, so this should go relatively smoothly.
Okay.
Tech-wise. Should be, yeah, that right down here is Zika. There you go, yep.
You could.
Should have a remote control. Paul should have it.
Hmm?
Remote control for that TV.
This is Paul's computer, so I'm going to do my best here. So, good evening. My name is Emily Glassberg. I work for Clark. I am an entomologist, and I'm also your account manager. I think this is my first time speaking in front of all of you, so it's nice to meet you. So tonight I'm going to be talking about a couple different things. First, just a quick overview of what your program entails, what Clark does with Darien to control mosquitoes each season. Secondly, I'll be doing a quick recap of where we are at right now in terms of West Nile virus. And then kind of like the second half of what I'll be talking about tonight per my conversation with Paul is just a couple of facts about Zika. I know there's been a lot of stuff in the media pretty much since like January, February, and the information is constantly changing, evolving. So we can talk a little bit about that and then maybe answer any questions you have, you know, when appropriate or at the end. Like I said, it's my first time talking with you and I'm a bug person. So a quick overview about what mosquitoes do in terms of their life cycle. Kind of like a caterpillar goes into chrysalis, becomes a beautiful butterfly. A mosquito spends about the first 2 weeks of its life, once it hatches from an egg, in a larval state. Okay, so typical season might be roughly like 10 days between when they emerge from the egg and when they hatch or pupate. Instead of becoming a beautiful butterfly, though, they become a blood-sucking mosquito. Interesting fact is only female mosquitoes bite. Males feed on pollen, but they're innocent victims of any control efforts we take. So this is what mosquito larvae look like, and you can find them in stagnant water. So if you've got a pond and you've got something like a fountain in your pond, or if you have a bird bath with flowing water, you're not going to have mosquitoes there. But if you have anything with still water, especially water that tends to get really stagnant, especially places like catch basins, like stinky, gunky water, that's what mosquitoes, and especially the ones that carry diseases locally, love. So most people think about mosquitoes and mosquito control, about controlling mosquitoes when they're in their adult form, right? When they're flying around, and most people have images of trucks fogging communities, right? So most municipal programs actually don't focus on adult mosquito control at all anymore. And in fact, Darien's program is almost entirely focused on controlling mosquitoes in their larval stage, which is really effective because you get to control them before they become biting adults, right? It's a lot easier to kill something before it has wings versus trying to catch it when it's flying all around. So these are just some images of what we do throughout the season to help reduce mosquito populations in Darien. We perform 12 inspections throughout the summer of breeding sites. We treat them with a larvicide if and when we find breeding. We also do some helicopter treatments for larval control. So your program entails surveillance, monitoring, and larval control. That's the core of your program. And these are just some images. So you have somebody dipping, essentially monitoring for larval activity in some cattails. Someone putting larvicide out into a pond. We also work with other communities throughout Illinois, especially in DuPage, to do different kinds of monitoring. So we monitor populations of all different kinds of mosquitoes, and we also monitor West Nile virus activity. So we can share that data with you throughout the season. So where are we at right now in terms of disease prevention and in terms of disease outlook? Primarily in this area, we're concerned with West Nile virus. That's what we tend to see out of all the different forms of encephalitis and other viruses that mosquitoes can carry. That's what we typically tend to see here. So right now, there have been 81 positive mosquito samples taken. So mosquitoes that tested positive for West Nile virus in Illinois. And 6 have been found in DuPage County. So just to give you an idea, for this time of year, that's actually kind of high. We typically don't see too much West Nile virus activity until August or September. And then in terms of birds, there have been 2 in Illinois, 0 in DuPage that tested positive for West Nile virus. Some late season factors influencing how this trend is going to go and how much risk there's going to be later in the season are primarily rainfall and temperature. So the reason why we're seeing a little bit higher levels right now is mostly because we've had these super, super hot days and nights with very little rain. So the last 2 or 3 years, we've had like a ton of rain. Last year, we had like the wettest June ever. That's a fact. It's not just what it felt like. So we had a lot of, basically a lot of water resources. But what happens is when there's less water resources, the mosquitoes come in contact with the birds much more often, and therefore West Nile virus can amplify more. There's more of a chance that they're going to pick it up from the birds and then come in contact with the human. So any questions on your current program or West Nile virus? Yes?
You said helicopter treatments.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what is that treated? We don't necessarily, like as the city of Darien, don't own lakes. So where are you getting those treatments?
So we have sites that are prone to flooding that are essentially too large or just really kind of inaccessible to treat by hand or by backpack. And we do those with a helicopter. The treatments are very specific, and it's with a larvicide. So it's not like a spray mist. It's a granular product that goes right down from where it's dropped. And that goes into areas, like I said, prone to flooding. The products have a 30-day residual. So if they might be dry, but then if it rains or if it floods, or if it's already wet, the product will stay there for 30 days. And we do 3 of those throughout the season.
Okay, and that might include, like on Lamont Road, there's Forest Preserve. That might be included in our program?
We can't do any sites within DuPage County Forest Preserve property.
Okay, so literally the lakes are larger water basins are in Darien that you're referring to.
Correct, yeah. Okay. And they're not necessarily, like, our breeding sites might not necessarily be all, like, huge, large areas. They might be smaller ones or, like, a section that tends to flood.
Okay.
It's just a long section. Yeah.
You said you don't do the Forest Preserve. What does the Forest Preserve do?
So the Forest Preserve runs their own mosquito control program. They buy product either through Clark or they receive it through the county.
Okay, so they do have a program. It's just that they don't...
Mm-hmm. They don't actually have you administer it.
Correct, yeah. And we're not, I mean, we're not really sure exactly of what.
Well, because that affects us dramatically.
It does, of course,
you know,
it does.
Because there's a lot of force preserve around us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I guess we need to find out from them.
Well, at some point.
Yeah, that's definitely a conversation to be had with them.
At some point, we talked to them and they had stopped. There's no spraying they do. So there are other treatments I would imagine are similar, but we can certainly follow up and see what those are. But they have not sprayed for a while.
Yeah, Emily, you know, we get that question all the time. Why don't we spray the, mm-hmm. you know, the fog machines that we all grew up with? Why? Give us an explanation of why that's not done any longer.
Right, and so I was actually just talking about this when I was sitting in the chair. One of the reasons why spraying is used much less is because larval control is just so much more effective. But it is a good way to complement any larval control that you're doing. So every community runs their program a little bit differently, but a good way to look at Darien's program is that, you know, it's a public health program. It's a program designed to prevent disease, right? You're not spraying because mosquitoes are annoying. You're not spraying because people get, you could if you wanted to. You could do a couple sprays when the populations peak, and we can advise you on when to do those, if that's the stance that the city wanted to take. Or you could take another route, which is the route that you have now. It's a public health program. So when there's a lot of West Nile virus in the area, when the numbers indicate that it's the responsible thing to do, you can perform an adult control treatment if you wanted to knock down some of those populations.
Yeah, I think we discontinued that because I think it was a health concern to residents, frankly, with the fogging machines going around.
I mean, there's the products that we use are approved by the EPA for use in and around residential areas, and as long as they're applied according to label, which we do, you know, those concerns might be more like a personal matter. But yeah, I mean, we can, you know, work with you or work around some of those questions that residents might have.
I'm not advocating,
right.
But you know,
I just
an explanation to residents why we don't do it, because it's not as effective as the methods we're using now.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if you're going to place the bulk of your program on something, it should certainly be larval control, because you're going to get the most bang for your buck always with the larval control.
Okay. I think part of it was a perceptual issue. When people saw the foggy machines, they actually thought something was being done, whereas the larvae treatment, they don't see that.
Yeah.
So I think you're coming forward and explaining this and being on public access helps a lot of people understand that something's being done.
Right. I mean, we come through, we treat your catch basins. We do like 2,000 catch basins in the city of Darien. We do a ton of breeding sites, but most of that, like I said, goes unnoticed because a person dropping something into a catch basin isn't quite as flashy per se as a truck coming through at night.
Do you do the?
I'm sorry, Alderman Klistic, you had a question?
Yeah. Do you guys also do the park district, like where the parks are, where kids are at as well, or is that not part or no? Can you explain a little bit there?
Yeah, so we'll do, so within the city of Darien, if there's breeding sites in your park district, those are covered under your program. But if the park district, we don't really do any adult control. So what happens is in some other cities that we work with or villages, sometimes the park district contracts with us separately to do things like, you know, a little bit of adult control for movie nights or for baseball games or things like that. Mm-hmm. And we can do something a little bit more localized versus doing an entire community application.
Dan, you had a question?
Yes, in respect to some of the residents, we get calls throughout the year where ditches, for example, or rear yards that hold water. How do you address them? Again, maybe you could explain to the residents, is it they call the 1-800-CLARK number, or should they be going through the municipality, and is there a number that residents should be calling?
Yeah, so we have a mosquito hotline, and they can call that up. What they can do is just essentially report standing water or mosquito breeding activity, and we'll come out like really quickly, like within usually 2 or 3 days, if not sooner, and we'll inspect it and treat it. And it's part of your program. So we certainly encourage residents to do that as much as possible. And I'll be talking a little bit about Zika and some of the ways that people can help protect themselves, and that's a great way to do it is to stay on top of any place that's holding water.
Any other question, follow up on that? Was catch basins in rear yards? You guys also address the rear yards as well, where you have the plans for?
We do. It's really helpful if people have a catch basin in their backyard to just either check with the city or get in touch with us and let us know what your address is so we can make sure that we have it, because we might not have the address.
Sure, sure. I know several years ago. We did a real, what we thought was a good atlas. And again, there's probably inlets and rear yards that we may not be even aware of at this point, but just wanted to get that information out there.
Mm-hmm. Alderman MacIver?
I just had a question about, like, are there any adverse environmental impacts from these larvicides and things that you're putting in, like, ponds and so forth with respect to
not when it's applied according to label. We also have our own in-house mapping division, so if there's any areas where there's like endangered species or any other protected areas or reasons why we like environmentally why we shouldn't apply XYZ there, we would be able to pick up on those.
Right, but I mean, if you're putting it in like a pond and there's, I mean, I'm thinking larvicide kills other things, not just, it's
right,
not
just so
targeting mosquito larvae.
Yeah, so the product that we use is called Altacid. The active ingredient is mathoprin. It's actually essentially like a hormone for the insect, for mosquitoes. And what it does is it prevents mosquito larvae from developing into adults. So they essentially stay like a little whiny larvae. They're kind of like drinking from the fountain of youth, and they never grow up, but then they die. So that's what it does. It's actually it's a great product to use, and it's very specific for mosquitoes' physiology.
DMA, piggyback on your question. Rear yard drainage programs, the new ones that you've got coming in, do you think they would be a candidate for this, getting those addresses to them, or no?
No, in this case, I mean, it's more than nuisance for more than nuisance concerns. The occasional 2-foot by 3-foot little pond that occurs, and you know, when the rear yard drainage programs, those refer to stretches,
right,
not isolated areas or ditches. In our case, again, you know, we don't have the funding for it, so it could be 300-400 feet, and that's also another separate issue on its own.
Okay, thank you.
Did you want to go ahead, Emily, with the rest of your presentation?
Sorry, Mayor, one question to lead off on, or to follow up on Dan's question. So as you're treating a catch basin, and let's say it rains, you have a lot of water, that obviously, where does that treatment go then? Is it literally, does it go into the other areas?
So your catch basin treatments, we use a product. It's actually like, it's a briquette, it's a tablet. It sits at the bottom of the catch basin. Okay. So it doesn't just go in and, like, dissolve. It dissolves very slowly. It dissolves over a period of 150 days, and it's designed to withstand a reasonable amount of water movement.
Is there a residual benefit then if that, in that sewer itself, or is it limited to the actual catch basin?
It's,
so you know,
it's limited to the catch basin.
It is. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you.
So each one of your basins on your street presumably would receive a briquette. Okay, so Zika. So outbreaks of Zika have occurred in Africa and Southeast Asia and the Pacific Islands, and more recently in the Americas. And because Aedes species mosquitoes are the primary vector of Zika, they're the mosquitoes that spread it, and because they're found all over the world, there's a very high chance that Zika is going to spread, presumably all over the world. So locally and in the U.S., most of the cases that we've been seeing have been travel-related. We've been seeing people going to and from the U.S., reporting symptoms of the virus, even though the virus wasn't necessarily acquired within the U.S. So what I'm going to do is just talk to you a little bit about why Zika is such a big concern, how it's transmitted, and what our risk is here. But these important cases, and the reason why it's so important to know about Zika is that these important cases might result in essentially humans bringing the virus to the mosquitoes, whereas in most cases it's the opposite. So it can result in human to mosquito to human transmission in areas where there's no Zika right now. So we're not so much looking at just insect movement, we're looking at people, travelers. Zika has four transmission routes. So Zika is spread when a mosquito that has the virus bites a human. The humans are also reservoirs for Zika. So if I have Zika and a mosquito bites me, that mosquito can pick up Zika from me. Zika can also be spread from the mother to the fetus. And it can also be sexually transmitted. Zika is unlike any other mosquito-borne virus that we've seen pretty much ever, just because of this transmission cycle that can happen. So whereas in the past, we were known as incidental hosts to most viruses, that means if the mosquito bites us, the virus can't really come out of us. Like a mosquito bites me and it has West Nile and I have West Nile virus, and another mosquito bites me, it can't pick it up from me, and I can't transmit it to someone else under normal circumstances. Whereas Zika gives us this whole different cycle of people being the primary host. Primates are the primary host for Zika. So if somebody with Zika comes into an area with the right kind of mosquitoes, that area can potentially be exposed to Zika. Just to give you sort of a picture, all these little green blocks up here represent routes of transmission. So Zika has the most transmission routes of any mosquito-borne virus. If you look at dengue or chikungunya or any of the other ones, really it's only spread if through like blood transfusions. But Zika, like I said, can be spread sexually. It can be spread from humans to mosquitoes, and from humans and from mothers to their fetus.
Does it have a life within a human body? I mean, like a typical virus lasts so long?
Yeah, so people tend to be symptomatic for like a week, 1 week, 2 weeks. However, the virus can stay in the system for a really long time, and it's actually constantly evolving what science is telling us. So a few months ago, they said that Zika could be found in sperm for up to 60 days. Now they're saying 84. Just this weekend, there was a report from CNN saying that now it can be transmitted from a female to a male, not just a male to a female. So that's something, I don't know that the CDC has verified that yet, but that's another thing that will probably be looked at as well. So right now, the answer is 84 days seems to be...
84 months or 84 days?
84 days. Did I say months?
I thought you said months.
I'm sorry if I did. It should be 84 days. Yeah. And, of course, one of the reasons why Zika has been garnering so much attention is because once it got to Brazil, once the virus came into Brazil, they started seeing a lot of infants that were exposed to the virus during pregnancy, having some different birth defects, microcephaly being the main one. So that kind of put a big target on Zika's back, so to speak. So there's been a lot more research done much more recently, like within the last year, than there had been previously, because these birth defects weren't known to be linked directly to Zika until very recently. So what kinds of mosquitoes can transmit Zika? Primarily, Aedes aegypti is the primary vector of Zika. The good news is it's not typically found in this area of Illinois. It's not typically found in most areas that are very, very cold because it's not a very cold-tolerant mosquito. You can find it in places like Florida, Brazil, places that are warm. Puerto Rico's has already had a couple Zika cases. There's also another vector called the Asian tiger mosquito, Aedes albopictus. This is the one that locally we're looking out for. So the good news is we don't have the primary vector here. Aedes aegypti isn't here in Illinois. But Aedes albopictus, the Asian tiger mosquito, the one with the kind of black and white stripy legs, has been found on occasion in this area. So what we're doing this summer is conducting a lot of surveillance to see how common it is. A couple of other just things to note. This shows, this map shows like the dispersion of both species. So you can see like we're looking at the green one locally. Like the green map shows the Asian tiger mosquito. So it can be found in Illinois. It's not super, super common. We're trying to find out how common it is. And you've heard probably in the news people saying there's been a case in New York, there's been a human case in Chicago, there's been human cases left and right. Again, all of these cases in the continental US thus far have been travel related. So either the person went somewhere or had been intimate with someone that had traveled, and that's how they contracted Zika. Just some information about what happens when you get Zika. So 80% of people that are infected don't show any symptoms at all. So that makes it kind of hard to tell if your partner, if someone else has come in contact with the virus. It is a mild illness in most people, so like even those 20% that do show symptoms, most don't have to go to the hospital. But the common symptoms are fever, rash, joint pain, and conjunctivitis. And the major concern, again, is the potential impact that Zika has on babies in the womb, particularly with microcephaly. Also, it's been linked to stillbirths as well. And there are strong indications that pregnant women who have become infected with Zika are at high risk for giving birth to a child with microcephaly. This is part of the reason why the CDC put out a lot of warnings for women who are pregnant, looking to become pregnant, or essentially not practicing safe sex, to avoid travel into areas where where Zika outbreaks are occurring, because they are essentially putting themselves in a very high-risk situation. There's also another disease, Guillain-Barré syndrome, and it's a rare disorder in which your body's immune system attacks the nerves. That's also been linked to Zika. So, again, there's a high risk of introduction in many places just because of travel importation, places that have the competent vectors. So right now, we don't really have, as far as we know, very competent vectors. We have a mosquito that's been shown to be capable of transmitting Zika in the lab, but not so common in the field. So that's good news for us to some degree. But again, it makes travel a little bit hard on some people, depending on where your plans to travel are. And so right now, what we're trying to do as much as possible is just prepare to minimize the risk of importation and to prepare for what happens if, for some reason, there's a mutation in the virus or something happens where all of a sudden we find ourselves in a situation where the virus can be spread by a mosquito here. One of the challenges that these mosquitoes pose to us and just mosquito control in general, as we're used to it, is that they're day biters. So they're day biters, they're container breeders, which means they don't like big, wet areas. They like bird baths. They like bottle caps. They like gutters. They're typically found like in and around people's homes. They feed primarily off of people. So they're not mosquitoes that fly around at nighttime that you could capture during a night spray, so to speak. So it makes the application timing and the choice of adulticide very critical should you need to control them. So some things to do, I mean, we already talked about, right now we're kind of in a low-risk area in terms of Zika goes. We don't have the species that normally transmit it. But what we're doing locally is just a lot of surveillance. Clark is working with different public and private entities to monitor populations of the Asian tiger mosquito. And we're also working, you know, in other areas of the U.S., like we have an office in Florida, on just some program modifications, like should someone have Zika, and if there is a chance that it can be transmitted by mosquitoes here, what would we do? How would we modify the program? So right now and for the summer, when people ask what can they do to avoid Zika or protect themselves from Zika, other than staying away from places that are known to have Zika transmissions occurring, They can look for breeding sites in their backyard. And this is actually great for any kind of mosquito, especially the ones that carry disease. So bird baths, kiddie pools, here's just a couple images there. And I actually brought some pamphlets that have a little punch list for homeowners. So I can leave them somewhere.
Okay.
So lastly, I'm going to skim over a little bit of this. But just because there's a high likelihood that sooner or later, Zika might come into contact with some of us or might occur in Illinois, either because we find that the mosquito that potentially can transmit it can, or because it's just being spread by humans. You know, it's just really important that we kind of keep abreast of all the information and protect ourselves as much as possible. So what Clark has done is put a Zika support center on our website. And our website is clarke.com. And if you go there, you can get information, especially like it's designed more for like municipalities and local governments, but you can get different templates for like press releases and things like that that will help you communicate to the residents. One, these are mosquitoes that carry it. Two, this is what we have here. We're in a low-risk area. Three, you know, you're not in like a Florida situation where it's a not if but when. We're kind of in a different situation here. So the thing to do is to just wear, you know, repellent and things like that during the day, be safe, and empty out as many breeding sites as you can or report them to the hotline.
So the current mosquito repellents that you can spray on your body are a good weapon against these mosquitoes?
Right. Well, any mosquitoes, yeah.
Okay.
But the difference is
these in particular.
Yeah. So the only difference is instead of just applying them, most people put them on in the evening. You might want to put them on during the daytime. Or if your family has a trip planned to like a warmer area, like one of the ones that Rashaded is having, Aedes aegypti, if you have like a vacation to Mexico or Puerto Rico planned, put your repellent on during the day.
If you're going out in the sun, repellent before suntan lotion or after? I mean, how do you mix the two?
I usually put it after, but
it's a good question. It's a good question.
A lot of times, I actually recommend just also spraying your clothes with it.
Okay.
Usually, will stick on a little bit better, especially if it's hot.
All right, I'm glad to see that you've really up your level of communication and information for residents and for us. So you don't necessarily send out a newsletter that we could, you know, make copies of and have here. We would have to go to your website, take the information off of there, and then put it on our website.
It's really pretty. It's really pretty handy. You can pick out a template that basically all you have to do is put City of Darien where it says your municipality here, and you just want to make sure that you're going to like the low risk templates and you're looking at the low risk areas and not the high risk areas because we're not in that situation. But if you have someone in communications that you'd like me to work with or put something together with, we're happy to do that.
We do. We'll make sure we get in touch, to get that link on our website. Yeah. Any other questions for Emily?
Could you share the number by chance? The 1-800 number you mentioned.
Oh, sure. It's let me see here. I should know it off the top of my head, but I'll inevitably mess up a digit and it'll go to some other one that nobody wants. It's 1-800-942-2555.
Thank you. You have it.
I didn't assume that you were done with your presentation, but are you indeed done? Okay. Thank you for coming out. I think it was very informative and
we
really appreciate the information.
Thank you.
Very well done.
We lost most of the crowd there.
The Boy Scouts just want to learn about mosquitoes. Okay.
hopefully with the scouts out.
Well,
all the time,
well, actually, that was the perfect timing for the scouts to be here tonight for this meeting. Really, it was. They came out for the purpose of seeing a city council meeting and being informed. And boy, they sure got a lot of information this evening. So, thank you very much, Emily, for that presentation. Claire Bongiovanni could not be here this evening to do the chamber update because she had a illness in the family. But I think she mentioned at the previous when she had her previous update about the downsized version of the fest this year. All of you should be aware of it, that it's only a one-day fest, but the carnival, since they still had the contract with the carnival, will go on for the 3 days. So. I don't know if we can bring her back maybe for the August meeting, suggested.
I let her know about that, and she'll get back to us.
Okay. Yeah, so that we can get it on the record as to exactly how it's going to be presented this year. So let's move on to the clerk's report.
I just have one item that Claire asked me to mention. We're all invited to Sears Outlet, which is located at 7415 Cass Avenue. It's under new ownership. They're going to have a grand reopening ribbons cutting ceremony, and it's to take place on next Tuesday, July 26th at 5 p.m. So everyone is invited to attend.
Let's move to the city administrator's report.
No report, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. Department head reports. I believe Chief Thomas has a report for us this evening.
Sure.
Okay. And timely, very timely, Chief.
Good evening, Mayor, Alderman, audience. The monthly report, there's a couple things I want to draw your attention to. on the second page, call for service summary, citizen-generated events. Very slight title change, but a little bit more substance change. The title change is top 10 incident categories. The substance is that there's a number of times where there's a single or several incidents, but it doesn't rise to a level where it's going to be reported. And actually, Alderman Kenny had asked me a number of meetings ago that he had a ride-along, and there was a number of calls and for medical assistance. And that kind of made me think about how to better report. And so, for example, that medical assistance, there's probably about 20 different ways for an ambulance to be dispatched for different types of things: chest pains, cardiac, breathing problems, back pain, assist the ambulance, on and on and on. So if you counted each one of those, you wouldn't get very many, but when you aggregate them all into a category, you get a significant number. So, in fact, I think the month after you had asked about it, it did actually get to the top 10, and it's out of the top 10 now. But that's the reason why they're aggregated the way they are, and there has been some change in how many incidents get into that top 10. So just a better way of reporting that information. On community engagement, directed patrols, I gave information to the officers about how we were going to count those because some individuals want to game the system and get credit for things, a handshake meaning I have done a community engagement. So we've defined the mission as a specific issue with a location, whether it's patrolling a hotspot because there's several burglary to motor vehicles, or a specific issue with a perpetrator. So you're looking at sex offenders, subject wanted on warrants, prolific offenders, and the like. So there's some direction there about what gets counted as a directed patrol and what doesn't get counted as a directed patrol. And the same thing for community engagement. When an officer would go inside for a cup of coffee and say hello, some would count that as a community engagement. That's not. So we gave us community engagement is for a specific reason or purpose that you engage the community in some type of enrichment, whether you're talking about some crime reduction, barrier breaking, talking at neighborhood talks, homeowners association, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, schools, fraternal organization, faith-based, and on and on. So there's some direction there. So you actually see a reduction there, and it's not necessarily that there's been a reduction in the amount. It's just more clearly defined. So it's actually pretty good to see that there is that many of community engagement, that many focus patrols that have now have clear defined ways of counting them. And then park duties. I know the mayor had asked me about presence in the park, and system sometimes is very difficult to get information out, or sometimes an officer will code it in different ways. So I might code it as a park duty, may count it as an extra patrol, may count it as a directed patrol, community engagement, different ways of doing that. So in order to get the mayor the report and the information she wanted, I actually did the search by location versus call type. So when you do that, I think, I can't remember, was it 66 or 86 contacts or something like that? So it's much different. So probably a little bit later when we start talking about the new system that DUCOM is trying to put in, we'll talk about some issues that we have with regards to the ability to grab data, count data, and do those types of things. Again, the place I like to turn to is crime summary, and I always look at part one crime, the 1 year change and the 5 year change. And again, part one crime is down nearly 44% over 5 years, and about 38% from this time of year, last year to this time this year. So those are all good things to see. Again, talking about some accuracy issues, I believe under the arrest summary, the continued page, and under a juvenile and adult arrest in June of 2015, I don't believe that that was a zero. But again, trying to get information out of our CAD and our RMS is very difficult. And so we're looking at better ways of trying to get that information out of the system. It's been pleasurable trying to figure it out. And that's about it out of the monthly report. Obviously, the first part of the monthly report is a narrative that I put together shortly after the shooting incident in Dallas, talking about probably one of the main themes is a fact and a feeling. You know, I think a lot of people want to throw out a lot of different facts. My prior engagement, I was known as the numbers guy, numbers man. So there's a lot of facts, a lot of figures, a lot of different things that are going out there. And we try to combat a lot of times a feeling with a fact. And sometimes it doesn't work. You know, I can feel a certain way. See, people can present facts, and I'm still going to have that same feeling. So I think the way that it has to be approached is a different approach than just spouting off a number of statistics. Is they actually have some good conversation back and forth. I talked about it in my briefing how I like to approach communication and trying to bring people around to my way of thinking, which is the right way of thinking. trying to allow people to have influence on you, and as the second part of that is to have influence on others. But you have to be willing to be influenced. Gather that information, hear that information, and like I said in the report, understanding is being able to, for me, to make your argument better than you can make it yourself. And then that shows that I have good understanding. And the second part of that is to be understood, so it has my courage to bring apart my argument to that other person. And then at the end of the report, I talk about the Darien Police Department and the training that we continue to do, both on hard skills, deadly force, less lethal force, handcuffing, all those skill type of things, as well as what might be called soft skills, cultural diversity, cultural awareness, cultural understanding, all those different types of things. So that's it.
Any questions for the chief? Alderman MacIver?
Chief, could you talk a little bit about the what we talked about in our meeting this evening?
Oh, the new program? Is that what you're talking about?
No.
The burglaries you're talking about.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. The motor vehicles? I had this in my hand. I looked down. As soon as you started talking, I thought, oh.
Motor vehicles?
Yeah, we had some a number of motor vehicle burglaries over the last couple days. Started late Friday evening into Saturday morning. On that time frame, late Saturday or late Friday, early Saturday, we had 10 motor burglary to motor vehicles. Four of them on 70th Street, a couple on West 69th Street. So there's a number of them. I don't
Chief,
know.
Was that the Hinsburg area or was that west of Cassie Avenue?
The second day, the 17th, yesterday. There was three reported, one on Gilbert, one on Aylesworth, and one on Spring Green.
Now, that's Ward 6.
Yeah.
But when you said 70th Street and 69th Street, were you referring to the Hinsburg area, east of Kansas?
It's the 500 block of 70th Street.
Yeah, that's east of Cassie Avenue. Okay.
Yeah, and so last night, in fact...
Yeah, one was on the northeast side, and one was kind of on the southwest side.
Yeah, so we had a cluster in Farmingdale Village last night.
Yeah. Chief, any feelings? I mean, we're not back to a gang doing this. We're back to kids.
I'm sure it's kids.
Yeah.
I don't know the numbers, but a significant number of them were open, and a number of them were sunglasses, loose change. I think one had some golf ball or golf bag taken.
Yeah.
So very small stuff. So I'm really not going to get
golfers,
a lot of
those. The golf bag is.
My apologies to Phil Mickelson and whoever else.
Chief, I'm going
to
ask you a really crazy question, and I'm going to get laughed at here, but it's a phenomenon. This Pokemon Go, with the kids are out on the phones and everything else playing. Do you think that contributes to anything that these kids are in these, you know, in looking in these cars for, you know, Pokemon or whatever the heck they're looking for? It's going goofy.
I've heard some reports. I've heard some reports of actual violence and cell phone thefts because of the Pokemon. I don't know any of the statistics. I wouldn't be able to venture a guess.
Okay.
Chief, one of the officers, I think, informed one of the residents that there's a reason they might be taking things like the manuals out of the glove compartments. I don't know if that's something that makes sense to not keep in your car.
Sometimes the manuals will put your, you know, especially on cars with the electronic entry, they'll put your electronic code in that manual. So instead of trying to thumb through in the middle of the night with no light, I'll just take the whole manual. And so then at a future date, I can see that car again, I'll be able to get into it. But manuals don't really mean much of anything.
It doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah, I think it's like with the newer technology ones where you can program buttons and things like that to get into, like, your open, you know, your garage or anything.
And once again, you said most of the vehicles were unlocked.
Unlocked. Yeah.
What do we have to do to our residents to get them to lock their cars?
I wish I had that answer, Mayor.
Yes.
I know in a prior job, probably more than half of things that were stolen, burglaries, motor vehicle burglaries, thefts out of wherever. More than half were unlocked or unsecured, and certainly looks like here the same. It's just a phenomenon.
Any other questions for the chief?
And just a follow-up. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, just a curiosity question. With regards to community engagement, do we have any patrols on bikes by chance, like downtown Chicago or biking, being engaged with the community?
We eliminated our BARC program years
ago.
Yeah. We
It's on utilities on cars, too, I guess, too. I guess.
In prior years, that was a program strictly on overtime, kind of an additional assignment, probably in 08 when the city took significant cuts in programs. I believe that was the year that we had, the council took that out of the budget at the time. Again, it was an overtime program.
Chief, did you come from the previous village you came from, city you came from, did they have a bike program, and was it effective?
Did have a bike program. It was not full-time, and we had community-oriented policing officers, a group of 18 officers, three sergeants that were specifically assigned to community policing, and for the most part they were the ones that would ride the bikes, and but it was for a very specific purpose and not as a general rule for patrol.
Okay.
It had minimal effect.
That's what
And Chief, I know we're going running along. Could you just touch it a little bit on when an officer gets called for non-criminal activity, where a community service officer goes to talk to somebody, residents might are looking for a ticket or looking for some action, and you know we had the discussion about the landscaper blocking a fire hydrant there about a month month back.
Most officers are. We'll look at situations singularly, case by case. So they'll look, and really what they're looking for is compliance. Now, enforcement may be needed in order to get compliance, but it could be just a simple request to move a vehicle, to put your garbage away, to drive slower, any number of things that officer believes that he's going to get compliance. Really, the enforcement comes in order to force or encourage behavioral change. So instead of speeding for the 17th time, you're probably going to start getting tickets, hopefully before the 17th time. But generally, that's the really what the officer is looking for is compliance. And if you can get compliance low level, then that's what he's going to do. If it takes a warning, it takes a warning. If it takes an enforcement action that costs a $120 ticket, or some other type of action, then he's going to.
Thank you.
And most of the time, it probably involves the police officer taking time to talk to the individual who became incensed over the situation to calm them down and get them to understand that they're trying to get compliance.
Well, I think it's on both sides. Both the person that you're trying to get compliance with, have that conversation, as well as the person that was complaining to make sure that that person's problem is resolved. There's some that just want everybody to be hammered, and that's not the approach that we're going to be taking.
Any other questions for the chief? Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Madam Mayor.
Oh,
just one quick item.
Yes.
As all the council members know, the developer for Darien Point was successful in having a lease executed with Starbucks. So Starbucks will be coming to the Darien Point Center located at Plainfield and Cass, and it looks like they'll be opening sometime in September.
There's another sign up in a window in the same building with a
Stylus.
Yes, yes. So that business has not been permitted yet?
That is Lady Jane's. They're currently working on
the
interior.
Contract?
And the interior is done, or I should say, in the
have we permitted that business already?
I'm not sure if the business license has been issued yet, okay. But they're in the process of getting all their information.
Okay. That's it, Dan?
That's it.
Okay. Do you want to give us an update? You and I have beat the dead horse on the lights, but you might as well bring the city council up to speed on our special lights.
On the 75th Street and Cass Avenue, lighting theme, decorative lights. The contractor resumed work again today. Most recently, he's put the heads up this afternoon. Majority of the heads, there's still some fixtures along Cass Avenue that need to be completed, as well as Plainfield Road. One of the latest issues was with restoration. Unfortunately, IDOT has a provision, and again, this job, please keep in mind, is federally funded. So with the federally funded project, there's certain Illinois Department of Transportation protocols that need to be adhered to. So in this particular case, sod, for example, cannot be laid in July and August per an IDOT revision or specification. So the restoration will be delayed till September. With that said, I think one of the things we're going to take a look at is to monitor if we do have some cooler weather coming up where we could request the county to have their engineer contact the contractor to put the sod down, and then after the first initial seven waters, typically the city would take over again, and that's provided there's some cooler temperatures that are in the forecast. The other issue recently was that the lights, if anyone has noticed, that the lights along Cass Avenue, the decorative lights, were parallel with Cass Avenue, and they should have been perpendicular. Unfortunately, the engineer made the decision to turn them on a parallel side versus perpendicular, so The lights have all been spun. Well, the majority of them have been spun around, so the decorative lights are now perpendicular. And we're hoping, or I should say I'm hoping, that some of the lights may be on this evening. It's been a long process with this contract. I feel that the contract should have been already completed 3 weeks ago. Unfortunately, there's been lighting issues with engineering, testing, and obviously with the Illinois and the budgets. That delayed things for an additional 3-4 days. So it seems like a constant series of things that come up and delay this project.
Okay, thank you. All right, let's move on to the Treasurer's report. Treasurer Korn.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This evening we have two warrants. First one, warrant number 161705, requesting Council's approval of the amount of $816,180.98 from the listed funds, payroll for the period ended June 23rd, in the amount of $252,848.12, for a total to be approved of $1,069,029.10.
Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman Belzec, seconded by Alderman Marquez. Discussion? The roll, please.
Belzec?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
McIver?
Aye.
Schauer?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
Kenny?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
The next warrant, please.
Okay, next.
Approved. That one is approved. Next warrant.
Warrant 161706, requesting Council's approval in the amount of $974,387.26 from the listed funds, payroll for the period ended July 7th, in the amount of $261,118.55, for a total to be approved of $1,235,505.81.
Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman Kenny, seconded by Alderman Schauer. Discussion? Then the roll, please.
Kenny?
Aye.
Schauer?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Belzec?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
McIver?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
The warrant has been approved. Let's move to standing committee reports. Alderman Marquez.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This evening, the Municipal Services Committee approved the minutes of the June 20th, 2016 Municipal Services Committee meeting, and we will submit those signed documents to the clerk's office. And then I'd like to announce that the next meeting of the Municipal Services Committee will be August 22nd, 2016, here in the Council Chambers at 6:30.
Thank you. Alderman Schauer?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Our next admin finance meeting will be held on Monday, August 1st at 6 p.m. in our upstairs meeting room.
Alderman McIver, do you have any information?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. This evening, the Police Committee approved the meeting minutes from the June 20th, 2016 Police Committee meeting. I have those for the clerk. And the next meeting of the Police Committee will be on Monday, August 15th at 6 p.m. in the Police Department Training Room across the parking lot, pending agenda items.
Thank you. Yes. Treasurer Korn has a report on the police pension.
The quarterly police pension board meeting will be conducted next Wednesday, July 27th at 7 p.m. across the street in the police training room. I would encourage all those interested to come out. In addition to reviewing the investment performance for the second quarter, well, for the period from April 1st through June 30th, the actuary will be presenting their actuarial report, which will assumably have the provision for what will be assessed for real estate taxes covering the police pension for the following year. I invite all residents, it is an open meeting, that is a line item on your real estate tax bill. If you'd like to find out and learn a little bit more about what's involved, the actuary will be there and open for plenty of questions and discussion if you so like to encourage as many as possible to attend.
Thank you. Let's move on to questions, comments.
I guess I should have taken Alderman Kenny's suggestion.
We should have had you up a little bit earlier. Yes, your name again? Your
John
name?
Dietrich. But this is in direct response to comments that came back to the Alderman. So I've lived at 7218 Bayberry for 10 years, since 2006. Previous to that, I grew up in Darien from 1970 to about 91. Always had a boat in my family, always had it on the driveway during the season. When I moved back to Darien to raise my family, I talked to my neighbors. None of them had an issue. The boat's been on the driveway for 10 years from about May 15th to October 15th. So this summer, received a citation on the door saying that, you know, you're in violation of an ordinance. Talked to Alderman Kenny, talked to Stephen back there, and learned that the complaint came from two blocks over. So the issue that I have is, you have an ordinance, and I understand the reasoning behind it. You don't want things left on driveways for, you know, years, months, not being used, whatever the case may be. You have bus-sized motorhomes parked on driveways, people living in them from time to time, which I do see. The position of the house on the property, the 5-foot setback for a parking pad, the side of the house to the property line is 106 inches. The width of the boat wheel to wheel is 102, leaving me approximately 4 inches to get it between the property line and the house. Doesn't leave me a lot of options other than to park it on the driveway. And to have an ordinance that now, being disgruntled as this other person was, when the complaint went against their motorhome, and Mr. Kinney goes to talk to him, and they say, well, what about this person and this person and this person? I could drive around Darien now and point out every trailer there, but they're not near me, they're not my neighbors, right? If you had an ordinance that's enforceable through an enforcement officer, and you're enforcing it equally around the community, but if you're enforcing something by complaint, why do we not have some kind of line of sight or some kind of reasoning behind the complaint that's justified? And when I read through, you know, people say, well, go get a variance. The variance to park in the driveway completely negates the reason for the ordinance. So to get a variance to park it there probably isn't going to happen. The 5-foot setback to get a variance to park it on the side of the house, being that to get it there, I'd probably have to drive on my neighbor's property, in which case, after a number of years, becomes an easement to whoever they sell the house to, probably isn't the best solution either, right? So it doesn't leave me as a resident with many options. Looking into external storage, not necessarily a cost issue at $450 for 6 months, though I already pay for winter storage, so the boat's never on the driveway during the winter. And the biggest thing is the detrimental inconvenience of the closest proximity where they have outdoor storage, because the boat will not fit in an indoor storage facility, is 20 minutes into Lamont, 20 minutes back, with say 15 minutes to get in and out of the lot, only accessible during daylight hours when someone's there working. Every time I want to wash the boat, maintain the boat, wax it, take it in or out, use it, I have to go pick it up from storage, bring it back to the house, load it up with all the equipment, then take it to where I'm going. It becomes an extreme inconvenience and detrimental impact to somebody who owns something like that during the season. And I think there's a lot of opportunity that can be reviewed again to understand, are there opportunities to say somebody with snowmobiles can park them from November to February? Can somebody with a boat park it from May to October? Do you have an opportunity to make money for the village and say you can get a permit sticker to park it on your driveway, provided that you can't abide by the ordinance based on the position of the house, the ability to get on the side or back part of the property? So I appreciate you listening to me. I do have some things written up. I was going to get my neighbors to sign. I'll be taking them into, you know, for variance. But what I read in the minutes from the zoning meetings and different committee meetings, I don't see a lot of appetite for helping out or accommodating the residents who have these type of vehicles.
What does the ordinance say about a period of time that the vehicle can be parked on the driveway?
There's typically a 3-day limit that contemplates wash. You know, if you can take a camper, you come back, you want to wash it, clean it out. So it gives 3 days.
Well, to be honest with you, we have not had an appetite to make any changes to that ordinance. I don't know if there's any change in feelings on the board, but that's basically what it is.
Just a quick comment from a neighbor trying to sell a house. You mentioned one person seeing like a couple RVs and stuff parked in a yard, and it already gives them an image like, you know, who else is going to put stuff out here? So I've actually got other complaints of things being left in yards or RVs left for many months. So I'm actually seeing some of those complaints from people trying to sell their property. So maybe that could be a potential reason why whoever called or whoever had that concern with you as well. So there's a guy down the street that parks a semi on occasion. Person, you know, you got to draw the line somewhere.
The person that complained has an RV. They park the RV from time to time. Their RV, they've done and they've parked it on the side. Mm-hmm. It extends past the front of their house. Somebody two blocks from them complained. Mm-hmm. Alderman Kenny went out while he was there talking to them for I don't know how many times to move their RV, saying we got another complaint. They said, well, what about the boat over here? What about the trailer over here? So it's nobody on my block. A house on my block sold recently. My neighbor's house sold right next door to me. I think when you're looking at something being there permanent, when you have motorhomes that people are living in, when you have somebody who has a motorhome and a boat and a trailer, I don't disagree. But I'm also a firm believer that people pay taxes, they maintain their house, they maintain their vehicles. They should have the right to use what they enjoy. And if I enjoyed motorcycles, and I had a $20,000 motorcycle, fits in my garage. But because my family are lake people and enjoy being on the water in a boat, I'm penalized for that.
But you decided the size of the boat to buy, right?
I don't think that's relevant.
Well, if someone brought a big yacht down the city of Darien, it'd be sort of an issue versus a small boat that someone parks
within,
in their yard.
It's within the ordinance's measurements to be on the side of the house. The problem is, from the edge of my house to the property line is 106 inches. The only way for me to get past that edge of the house, the ornamental edge, is either to take that off my house, which I think is absurd to ask, or to be able to drive on my neighbor's property every time I want to put the boat on the side or in the back of the house.
It becomes an aesthetic thing, and I understand it and I respect it, and it's, you know, that's why Darien's a nice place to live. But you look at sometimes there are people that have automobiles. There's a, you know, a home in town that the gentleman's got an automobile, and it's just a mid-sized car, and he's got this goofy looking tarp over it, and you know, his boat is more pleasing to the eye than this car with this tarp over it. Yet he's breaking a line, and I'm looking at it from an empathetical standpoint.
With regard to that vehicle, it has to be operable. It has to be able to be moved. It has to be licensed.
And
it has to be permitted.
It is.
Okay, all of those. That's part of all of our rules, also.
But when you talk about aesthetics, if I wanted to paint my garage door fluorescent pink and say, Darien's out of their mind, they won't let me park my boat in my driveway, you don't have an ordinance for that. All the neighbors would hate that more than my boat, but I could legally do that and I wouldn't get fined. When I was buying my house, moving back into Darien to raise my kids where I was raised, right? If I bought my house four blocks over on Washington, which is unincorporated, my boat could be there and Darien doesn't say anything about it.
That's correct.
Right? So when I drive through my own neighborhood, right, Farmingdale, there's a motorhome in unincorporated with people living in it. There's trailers, there's boats, there's work trucks, all in the same neighborhood, right? But somebody who has something they take care of and is only there for 5 months out of the year pays for off-season storage, so it's not on the side yard, not in the backyard, is penalized. And I think it comes down to the ability to use and enjoy your property, which going to external storage limits my ability to do that.
Mayor, just a clarification. I recall as the council was going through this, two items. One is the staff was asked to be reactive on this, so everybody, especially the new aldermen, understand. There was a number of residents we gave, when the ordinance was passed, plenty of, I think there was a year or some time period. But again, that was the direction of the council. We've been following that, so we are being reactive. So on a complaint basis, we do respond to those. And in terms of zoning, when the council adopted this, there was some explanation that it's not an aesthetic code, because we talked about that today on the phone.
That's what was told to me.
Yeah, we talked today on the phone about that, and it wasn't for aesthetics. It's just, it's a general zoning issue, just like you could have the height of a house regulated. Well, that's not necessarily aesthetic. It's more of a strict zoning issue, which this parking of vehicles fell in line because, again, the council's not regulating aesthetics in terms of a basis for law on that ordinance. Just, I wanted to clarify that.
Okay. I guess I will just thank you for bringing this issue forward, and we'll see if there's anyone that wants to address that issue. But we've been pretty firm on that, on this issue of this regulation.
So has it come up previously where the physical house doesn't allow for the vehicle to abide by the ordinance?
I believe so. Yeah, I believe we have
a number of years ago. We had numerous complaints, and what we did, we actually met a number of meetings where we asked the staff to provide us with information with regard how we could deal with it. It wasn't something we just did willy-nilly and said this and that. We actually investigated it. We looked at homes, different types of homes. We looked at what would be accommodating in terms of a home and where it should be and the measurements. So everything that we have in order now was something we've discussed over and over and again until we agreed upon certain parameters for it. So it wasn't something we established without thinking about it. We actually gave a lot of thought to it. We spent several months of Municipal Services Committee meetings going through it, looking at it. We had people come in who owned boats, who owned recreational vehicles, things like that, snowmobiles on trailers. And we looked at every one of those items, and we looked at what we could do to make it as accommodating as possible for the people who own those things. We were very open-minded about people like yourself who had a recreational vehicle like that, like a boat or the snowmobiles, and we made accommodations as much as we could with regard to the ordinance. So it wasn't something we did to punish people. It was something we did to create parameters so people would have something that they could actually live by.
I think the issue that I have, though, is that it's completely complaint-driven, and the complaint can come from anywhere. So I could be disgruntled, drive around the area now, and give you about, I'd probably be able to give you 50 complaints tomorrow for the exact same thing. So it's not enforced unless somebody complains, and that somebody could be in a different neighborhood just driving through, and because they got, their neighbor didn't like it, they're going to call on everyone else. So I think it's something you either enforce or you don't. And if you're not going to enforce it, then why have the ordinance? But I guess my other question is, the adjustments that I would have to make to my house and to go through a variance for a parking pad on the side, it is doable. Obviously, I got to cut an ornamental structure off the side of the house. I got to get a parking pad poured. I got to get a variance for the 5-foot setback because I got to go all the way to the property line. That's not going to happen overnight. I think the extension that Alderman Kenny got me is till the 22nd. And what are the options of being able to go through that process and understand what my options are to do that before I have to move it?
Dan, if I recall, we had a similar situation where I think the resident was putting forth a good effort and was given, you know, an appropriate amount of time to take care of that.
As far as the time goes,
yes.
You're correct. And there was two, I believe there was, and I have to double check if there was a variance that was granted. Again, I have to double check that. But in one situation, fortunately, unfortunately, the residents had taken the eve
off the house.
Off the house.
Motorhome one that was in your minutes.
Okay.
I read that.
So, right. Right, exactly. So, yeah. I mean, I have no problem coming out and meeting with you, you know, perhaps over the next couple of days and see what opportunities there are. And maybe there's some suggestion that I could bring forth if Steve hasn't already.
Well, Steve's been out and measured. I know that Alderman Kenny was out and measured. I'd be happy to entertain that and have you come out and look at it. like I said, I have 4 inches of clearance right now. If I adjusted, you know, the Gallagher and Henry houses have those things off the garage. If I take one of those off or adjust it, I can get more clearance. But again, I can't, you can't park this thing in the grass, it would sink. So it's got to be on a hard surface per the ordinance, and I'd probably have to get almost all the way to the property line with the parking pad.
I think you're asking for an extension while you go through the variance process. That's probably what you're asking. That's doable.
That's very doable.
We can meet over the next couple of days and decide whether or not if you want to move forward with the variance process, you know, then we can extend it based on the variance.
Okay.
And I would like to be informed, even though that isn't my ward, just to monitor how this is going, because, you know, the last thing you want to do is discourage residents from, you know, being able to enjoy, you know, their hobbies that they have. And this kind of thing snuck up on him. I mean, not everybody follows every single change in the ordinances that we have. And, you know, I just would feel bad. I don't want to drive somebody out of town over something like this.
Well, the interesting thing, Ms. Bailey, is that when the ordinance was passed or revised, I talked to the previous third ward alderman, and I talked to the police department. Police said, we don't enforce that. It's enforced by the zoning committee. The alderman said, he came out, he looked at it, he said, you know what, it's by complaint. If you've talked with all your neighbors, you know, wait till you get a complaint, see how things go. That's how it's been for 10 years. So as a resident, same thing. If we're not going to enforce something, except when someone complains, then the only reason we have it there is so we don't have to deal with the complaints.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. What, did anyone else in the audience want to address the council? Okay, let's move on to, and I believe everybody on the council, we've already addressed everybody's questions during our work session. Let's move to all business. There is no old business. Let's move right to the consent agenda. And during our work session, we added a number of items to our consent agenda. We took items B, C, and D off of the new business and put them under consent agenda as items E, F, and G. So I would like to ask for a motion to approve items A through F on our A through G on our consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve Alderman Marquez, seconded by Alderman Belkey? The roll, please.
Marquez?
Aye.
Belkey?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Schauer?
Aye.
Kenny?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
MacIver?
No. Oh, aye. Sorry, I was waiting for the next one.
Seven
eyes. Wow. She's anxious.
Okay, seven ayes. No abstentions or anything. All items have been approved. Let's move to new business. Item A is a motion to approve the closing, the dates of Darien Fest, Saturday, December 10th for Darien's Fest, the road closures for the Windy City Amusement, providing police protection and the public work services to Darien Fest, those reimbursements, and granting a waiver of $50 a day temporary liquor license. That's all of item A. Item B is, that's right. We're going to vote on one at a time. Do I have a motion to approve the Darien Fest items? Alderman Belzec, seconded by Alderman Schauer. Any discussion? The roll, please.
Belzac?
Aye.
Schauer?
Aye.
MacIver?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
Kenny?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
Belkey?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
A motion has been approved. Item B is a motion to approve a resolution authorizing a private, a private property development stormwater management assistance project for 3012 Hillside Lane and 2989 Harvest Place with J&R Landscaping and Tree Services in an amount not to exceed $10,300. Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman Belzec, seconded by Alderman Belkey. Discussion? Alderman MacIver?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Although these residences are in Ward 6, I am consistently opposing the private property improvements that are mostly funded by the city. So I just want to go on record that that is the reason I am voting no for this.
Any other discussion?
And I will echo Alderman MacGyver's comments.
Alderman Kenny, I have a problem with that, because you were the beneficiary of a private.
And I've said that, Mayor, and I will write the city.
But you're voting against somebody else's right to have the same thing you had done at your house.
Correct. And I've said that when we first did this, that times have changed, and we've looked at it. And my little backyard project was a couple hundred dollars. We're talking about thousands of dollars. I never once hid that I was a benefit of that program. Once we opened up and expanded the program and seeing the cost was going to be to the city of Darien, I then, you know, along with Alderman MacGyver, you know, changed my stance.
The roll, please.
Belzak?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
Kenny?
No.
Marquez?
Aye.
MacGyver?
No.
Shower?
Aye.
5 ayes and 2 nays.
Motion has been approved. Next item is a motion to approve a resolution authorizing the execution of a letter of intent to participate in the DuPage Judicial Information System. Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman MacGyver, seconded by Alderman Belzak. Any discussion?
Did the council want to hear about this? I don't think we really heard about this during our...
You know what? That's a good... did you want to address it, or do you want Chief Thomas to address
it? Yeah, I'll let the chief do it.
Okay.
Short and sweet, though, Chief.
No problem. Okay. One of the issues that was brought up in the pre-council meeting was making sure that the numbers were correct. The numbers that were provided in the packet totaled 379. And the numbers on the agenda memo totaled 373. The issue there with that $6,000 is that the 2016 money is included on the memo or the information that you got in the group packet, that big packet. In the summary, I did not put that on there because 2016 has already been dealt with.
That's the difference?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, and the benefit of changing, moving over to this this program, Chief?
Yeah, there's a lot of benefit. The let's real fast. CAD, computer aided dispatch system, is the process that DUCOM uses to manage the calls. So whether a call comes in through 911, non-emergency, an officer calling in on the radio, an officer making an entry on his MDC, mobile data computer. It doesn't matter how that information gets into telecom. They're the ones that are going to manage it, and they manage it through this software, computer-aided dispatch software. DuCam's going to go that direction, and so there's some cost that we have to share in that. The largest part of that money, costs of going to that system, the CAD system from Intergraph, the company is the vendor, is going to be picked up by ETSB. So there's a significant savings there, but we are on the hook for some of the funding. The other part of the process is our RMS, records management system. They currently use NetRMS. Very outdated and very difficult to get information. I was relaying, I just wanted a simple information about how many arrests each officer makes per month. In order to get that, I run a report that's 250 pages long, and then I have to sort through that all that information. I'm not going to do that. So trying to get the information out of the system is very difficult. We talked about being data-driven, goal-oriented, and intelligence-led. You can't be data-driven if you don't have the data. So it's very important for us to move to this new system. I believe there's 31 police departments and 14-ish fire districts that'll go to the system. That's why it's broken down the way it is. The committee that put this together looked at the number of total users, divided it out, and I believe we're at 2.17% of the group, so that's how we came across that funding. There's been some changes in the funding. The ETSB at one time was paying for part of the RMS system. There's been a new legal requirement or interpretation of the statute that says that that can't happen. Mm. And so now each one of those municipalities are going to have to pick up a bigger share of that funding because of its the legal issue of being able to pay for it or not. And the answer has been no.
Okay. Is there going to be a period of adjustment for changing to this a new system?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, especially for CAD, the computer aided dispatch. That'll be almost entirely the training and coming across new systems felt by the DUCOM, not necessarily by the officers. There'll be some because of the MDT communication between the computer and the car and the communication at the 911 center. There'll be some, but that's not too much. On the other side, on the records management side and field-based reporting and those type of things, there'll be some significant changes in that process. There's some, you know, subtle differences. You know, field-based reporting is field-based reporting. So, you know, you're putting the name of the person, date of person, birth of the person. You're following a narrative, you know, of first person, chronological order, past tense, all those things. So those things are all still apply. So there's a lot of similarities. But there are going to be some differences that will require training as well.
Okay, training for our officers, for our
correct.
Staff also. Okay, all righty. Any other questions for the chief? Then the roll, please.
McIver?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Klistic?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Schauer?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
Kenny?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
The motion has been approved. Let's move to questions, comments, and announcements from the council. Anyone? Alderman Marquez?
I don't want to take up a lot of time, but I was asked to bring this forward tonight. The Darien Lions Club is looking for an opportunity to expand its storage capacity. We currently, with the permission of the Darien Park District, utilize a space upstairs in the Sportsplex, which we've outgrown. And with our new flag program, we're looking for additional space. And Dennis Breyer, who's the president this year, has as one of his goals the opportunity to look for, or present us with the opportunity to look for additional storage. And it forced a discussion that I had with Mr. Gombeck regarding the ways we might be able to work with the city. And last Friday, Dennis and I met with Mr. Gombeck at the corner. Well, actually, it's the property that the facility that's just northwest of the intersection of Plainfield Road and Manning. It's the it's an old
plant
water,
four. It's referred
plant
to
four. If you look at it, it's where we used to impound our cars, and it's surrounded by a black fence. There is a building there. And again, the Lions Club hasn't approved anything. There has been significant discussion about it. The Board of Directors has talked about it. So this is an inquiry. But I'm looking for some direction from you, Madam Mayor, and from the council. When we met with Mr. Gombeck the other day, we had Mr. Thrum out there as well. We talked about the possibility of doing an engineering study to find out whether or not the pad that's there that they used to park the cars on is, if you're not aware of it, there's a 9 foot, 65 by 35 foot underground structure there, which has about 4.5 feet of water in it right now. And the question is whether or not that area could support a facility, an additional facility. So the engineering study would have to be conducted $1,000 to $1,500, and we talked about whether or not that we would actually share the cost or pick up the cost of that engineering study. What we're presenting and what we're possibly discussing, and again, our Lions Club are off for the summer, so the board, the directors would have to make some decision, go back to the membership, would be even the idea of tearing down the building that's there and now and building a brand new facility on the entire property that we would then share with the city, and the city would be able to use that for additional storage. And as some of you know, Dan's talked about the need for additional storage, and when we were with Mr. Thrum on Friday, we talked about how they currently use that for what, Dan?
grass cutters, things like that.
Seasonal products that get stored when they're not in use, obviously.
Seasonal. So I guess what I'm looking for now and what Dennis, the president of the Lions Club, is looking for is some direction. We will not meet again as a club until August. So no financial commitments can be made by me unilaterally. It would have to be done by our board of directors. But we at least like to get the process started so that when we do meet again and we do have an opportunity to discuss it as a board and as a club, we would know the city's feeling on it and what we could possibly do. So I guess what I'm looking for, Madam Mayor, is whether it should be something that we assign to a committee or we look at so that we could at least talk about the possibility of what we can do.
Well, I think I already talked to Dan about this, that I think we need to assess the situation and to see if it's even doable. The fact that there's water in that that facility, that's got to be addressed. You realize you'd probably be paying a rent to us. That was one of my biggest questions, why you would move from the sportsplex where you have no rent to come into one of our facilities where you would probably have to be paying a lease.
And again, the Park District has done a wonderful job at assisting us, but the space is upstairs, it's small, it's overcrowded, it's difficult to get to, and we've outgrown it. When we discussed this with Dan, Dennis even indicated that we would have a discussion as to even picking up half the cost of building a new structure on that property. So we haven't talked about a lease agreement. We haven't talked about any of those things, but that's where we're going. And again, we could go back to our club and our board and they might say, we don't want to do this, but we at least, you know, we're at a difficult point because we don't meet again until August or early September. But right now there's a real motivation to find something that's going to suit our needs in the years to come. We're looking at our flag program being anywhere between 500 and 1,000 homes in Darien, which would mean 100 flags and 100 poles would have to be stored somewhere on the days that we don't have those flags up. Well, we don't have the capacity for that. And the reason that Dennis would rather deal with the city than deal with the private entity is, I guess he trusts the city, and he knows who he's dealing with, he knows the people he's dealing with. And to be quite honest with you, that corner is a real nice center of Darien type of area for us to get to. As Alderman Belzac knows, when we stage our 4th of July parade, we could actually bring our float on that property and build our float over there and then go over to the parade. So it offers us some other opportunities as well. So we're willing to look at some of the conditions the city wants to set, and but we need to know what conditions the city is going to set.
I'm not opposed to it. I just I don't think we need to be in a position of spending money when we don't have to.
And regardless of what happens, first and foremost, an engineering analysis of whether or not the building can sustain or the pad can sustain any type of weight, and what's the maximum weight that it could potentially withstand, along with possibly utilize looking at the base, I'll call it the basement, it's an old water reservoir, right, to determine whether or not the walls are structurally sound and or if additional work needs to be done there or it needs to be demolished.
Can we do this investigation internally without expending any money?
No. Okay. No, we do need a structural engineer on this at a minimal.
But he hasn't got a board meeting to make that judgment. So we, like I said, we are amenable to looking at it. It's just a case of, I guess we have to wait until your board meets to even know if they would be ready to step up and pay for.
And even an expenditure of $750 to $1,500 would have to be approved by the board. And I don't know if what he could do during the summer, if he would call up all the board members and poll them in terms of that expenditure, but then would actually have to even be an email out to the entire membership approving it as well. That could be done. Dennis is real anxious to see this happen, and Tom's been on the board, and he knows the Board of Directors wants something like this to happen with regard to storage. So I don't know how much he'd be willing to do this summer to at least push the engineering cost. If he would give us a definitive figure and say it's going to cost $1,500, then he has to make a decision whether or not he wants to go back to his board now and find out.
I think we'd have to reach out to a couple consultants, professionals, for at least a good solid quote and what the services would include.
Yeah, Dan, I don't know if we've checked out, I thought of this fairly recently, but the zoning of that parcel. Obviously, as a specific zoning, as a municipal use, we'd have to make
Correct.
Sure that that...
And that was some of the logistics yeah. that we also touched about, yeah. touched base on very
right.
briefly, and at least wanted, as I told yeah. Alderman Marquez, to broach this through the city council
right.
With respect to the mayor.
Yeah, we talked about that location. What was the other location we talked about? The one farther down on Manning Road?
Correct.
Yeah, I think that the location, that was another location
there was
you
one
and I
that,
talked about.
There
plan two, I think, is the other one we're referring to. Plan two is a cellular communication center. Just real briefly, for those that don't recall or are newer to the city council, part of the, when the garage was built next to the plan two, the water tower, there was three leases or storage spaces for cellular equipment, and the goal of that was a buy-in cost and then to lease it, and that paid for the entire garage at that time. And I believe it's about $2,500 a month expense there, and I believe the size of that room is 10 by 18, I believe it was.
Was that big enough for what they're looking for?
I don't know.
Okay.
They were trying to determine it.
Probably not. In fact, the facility that's there, the building that's currently there, when we had the original discussion, I went to Dan and I said, if you don't need that facility, could we set up a lease agreement just to use that building? And when we met with Chris on Friday, Chris had, and Dan Salvato had already told Dan Gombeck, we need that to put our mowers and other equipment. And we actually went inside and looked at it. And while it's fairly empty right now, they'll probably put things in there. Chris said, to be quite honest, it'd be nice to tear that down, just build one brand new facility. But that building right there would be ideal if the city didn't need it for their own storage.
I told Chris, good comment too, by the way. No.
We're just looking for some direction, and again.
Okay, so you're going to go out, you're going to get a couple of quotes?
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other comments from the council? Then
I just have a quick question on the survey that was passed to us, the City of Darien survey, and how is that finalized, and when will that be going out?
Paul addressing that?
Paul and I talked about that this morning, actually, and we didn't get any feedback back from the council in terms of changes, so we're putting together a schedule. The goal is to make sure that we have all the results whenever ultimately the goal setting session is set. So there was a couple of things we were talking about, definitely direct connect and electronically. Last time we did the survey, we included it in the newsletter, and we were talking about alternatives to that, maybe just give right to the seniors club copies and try to get it back. But we're putting together that schedule now, but again, the end date should be for the goal setting.
Did you get my comments on that? Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realize you, okay.
Thank you. All right, if there's no one in the audience to address the council, I'd like to ask for a motion to adjourn. Alderman MacIver, seconded by Alderman Belkin. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
And you can find out what Starbucks is paying.
Is that down to the
giant? As a basis?
Got a new spot.
Along with the